I want to tell you how I got started with this. Some, almost 40 years ago, I was a first lieutenant in Vietnam, working night shift, taking care of patients, and a young man who had been severely injured was in the recovery room, and he said, "Please, can I talk to you?" And the first thing he said to me was, "Please understand and believe me, this happened to me."
Yeah, it was better before.
Yeah. I think we're interrupting what she's...
It's okay. Put the lights up. You know, they can see it well enough. And so when I talked to him, he said, okay, and he started to tell me about this experience he had when he was injured. And I had no idea what it was. This is 1969. I'd never heard of it. I'd never read about it. Nothing had been written about it in 1969. But I also could see that he was intensely emotional about this and that this was really, really important to him. And of course, what I came to find out later was it was a pretty typical near-death experience. But we didn't know that. Raymond Moody didn't write the first book about it until 1975. The term near-death experiences is not really accurate anymore. But when Raymond was doing his work and research, they were all cardiac arrest patients who actually had almost died or were near death. What we've come to find out in the 40 years since then, that you could be sick, you could have had a near drowning, you know, we'll talk about other things, but you don't necessarily have to be near death. So today what I want to do is give you a good definition, talk about some of the characteristics and after effects, a couple of things about what's going on now, and provide some guidelines for your practice, because this is not being handled in the VA. If they go to the VA typically and try to tell people about their near-death experience, they are put on medication and told them that they're bipolar. And it's not happening in the hospitals. It's not happening anywhere. We get them showing up at our organization all the time because they're just trying to tell people what happened to them and they're not believed. And that is why it is so important for the DAV and all people in practice that see veterans to be able to support them. It is a lifelong experience. This isn't something that happens and goes away. Once this happens, they have a whole bunch of characteristics during it. And then they have a lot of after effects that kind of are cumulative. They might happen right in the beginning, or some might not happen for 20 years later. But I can tell you they will talk to you and tell you the exact same discussion they had 40 years ago. Those of you who got a newsletter, that's our most current newsletter. This is a young chopper pilot from Vietnam. I met him last year at my own Vietnam reunion. And he started telling me about his injury because he was brought to the hospital where I was stationed. And after I talked to him for a few minutes, I said, his name was Mike also, I said, "Mike, you had a near-death experience." He said, "Well, I tried to tell the doctors about it, but they didn't want to hear about it." And he had a severe back of his head blown off. And he went on to Walter Reed and was under care for a couple of years. And nobody wanted to hear about it. And so I said, "You need to write this down, and you need to come to our conference and tell people about it." And so he will be September 3rd through 6th. We have our first, our 40th annual conference. And he will be, for the first time, talking about his experience. And he also is a chaplain. He was called to do that after his NDE, which is quite typical of people changing professions and going to altruistics careers. So we'll talk a little bit. A near-death experience is when, and I like to call it some kind of clinical crisis. Had a bad fever, their blood pressure fell out, they almost drowned. You know, they were very sick, they were in an operation. I mean, there's lots of different circumstances. There's about 15 universal. These are universal characteristics, happen around the world. Doesn't matter what religion, what anything that you have, these are all the same characteristics. We're particularly talking about veterans. And these usually happen during combat, during training, you know, sometime while they were on active duty. Doesn't really matter. But I have been specifically trying to get that more support for veterans because they're so frightened to talk about it because they think it'll affect their benefits. And if they start talking about this, they're afraid somebody will think that they're crazy, which is exactly what's happened, unfortunately. Who has NDEs? Everybody, anybody, any age, any gender, any culture, any religion or lack of religion. We have atheists and agnostics, any social group. So and there's none of this, nice people have nice experiences and bad people have bad experiences. That's not the way it happens. Just a few things, and these are old. I would love for the Gallup poll to update these. In 97, they estimated there were 15 million experiencers. Does not include children, does not include the elderly. The incident for children who have near drowning, that's the most common thing for children, is 70% of children who have near drownings have NDEs. There was a 13-year study of a Dutch physician who studied cardiac arrest, and he found about 12%, and there's some more current information that's about 18% had NDEs during his study. I can tell you I have talked to 10 people, and I've talked to thousands of people, and the first lecture I ever gave many, many years ago, I took a near-death experiencer with me. After that, I never have, because I can tell you 10% of any room full of people will have NDEs. And it just, they might not want to talk about it. They might not, you know, show that initially. And maybe they've never really understood it. And many times, after I get done, they'll say, oh, I had that, but I was just trying to explain it away. So very, very interesting with that. These are some of the circumstances: combat, extreme trauma, a heart attack, near drowning, most frequent cause for children, electrocution. We have a orthopedic surgeon in upstate New York who was electrocuted. And post-electrocution, he was able to write classical music and play it. Never played the piano before in his life. Has many, many other things that happen. He's a practicing orthopedic surgeon today. So we're starting to see the physicians having these experiences, and many of them didn't believe it. They didn't understand it until they had the experience themselves. Traumatic brain injury, difficult because the soldiers who come and see you have had traumatic brain injury, and many times this, when they try to talk about it, is just discounted as part of their injury. Certainly accidents, allergic reactions, people who have serious illnesses, extreme distress of some kind, and having surgery. They happen during surgery, and all of these things are potential areas where people have had these experiences. Characteristics. I'm going to tell you about 15 characteristics that we typically hear about. And you might have one, you might have three, or you could have all 15 of them. But these are universal characteristics. People talk about watching from the ceiling. They're in the OR, they're in the ER, they had a heart attack, they were had combat issues, and all of a sudden they find themselves watching from the ceiling their resuscitation. And they're trying to figure that out. What, am I dead? Am I, what is going on? But it's a separation from their physical body. Whatever people are comfortable with, it's their soul, it's their spirit, it's something. And they are looking at things around and can travel wherever they want. We have some very interesting stories about that. Difficult to describe. No language really available to describe the things they're feeling or seeing. Meeting spiritual beings. Some people meet spiritual beings on the other side, and some feel like the light is a loving, living component of being a spiritual being, and they're surrounded by love and those kinds of things. Not everybody has this aspect of it, but some people do. A bright, beautiful light is part of an experience for some people that they see, and many of them talk about it being the most loving, the most content, the most peaceful being they've ever felt. And it's alarming, apparently. Knowledge of nature. They know why the world is connected, how all things are connected to each other. They know how we're connected to the trees and the grass, and they look at all this. And they get a lot of knowledge. Anything they ever wondered about, they can just think about it and get that knowledge while they're on the other side, so to speak. So this is just a picture of how they kind of are going out of their physical body. Being greeted by a religious figure. We have people that talk to us about angels, you know, a lot of discussion about that. It is a very powerful light, a very beautiful light. It's very bright but not noxious, and people talk about being surrounded with it. I've had people tell me, I just wanted to stay there. I wanted to be surrounded by that light. It was pure love. I didn't want to come back. Very interesting, because as a nurse, I have resuscitated people and they were really angry. And so now we understand, why are you angry? Because you took me out of this beautiful, loving place and now I'm in this wreck of a body. And so makes sense now. There is another characteristic called a life review. And people will talk about being in a room and there are all these pictures, like TVs everywhere. And on these pictures are incidents or things from their life that they weren't really very proud of. And they will experience what happened. Maybe they bullied somebody in high school, or maybe they stole something from a store or something. You know, there are all these different incidents. And then they will talk about how they experienced it from the other person's point of view. So they're going to experience it as being bullied and understand the consequences and feelings about that. Very, very strong things happen during this life review. And so I'm sure you can all think of people who none of us are very proud of and have done some horrible things. And I always think, well, when the life review comes around, this is not going to be a pretty picture for them. They will sense a border or a limit to where they can go. And it's sort of like, if I can get past those trees, I can stay here. But many times they will talk about, I was moving toward the trees, or I was trying to be you know, part of this, and all of a sudden, I was just sent back. And not that they wanted to go back, but they were sent back. Some people talk about a sensation of flying through a tunnel with a white light at the end, and they're trying to reach the white light. Some people talk about people there to guide them, family members, deceased family members, other spiritual beings. It is a place where all knowledge exists. So anything they're interested in or want to know about, they can find out about there. They will find out about it. And while they're out of their body, they witness events that happen in the OR, in the waiting room, and they are able to talk to people and say, you said exactly this while I was being resuscitated in the ER, or while I was having surgery, the doctor said this. And so they frequently have really many different witnesses that can really talk about exactly what they saw and then be supportive of that. This is the limits, the tunnel people talk about in a lot of different ways, and going through a tunnel and feeling like they're just flying. It is an exhilarating period of time. These people, after they have this experience, they will remember it in detail. Some people will say, oh, you had a dream. You don't remember dreams after a while. These experiences, they will remember in detail for many, many years, for a lifetime. Once again, the sense of love and light. And many times, they will talk about a city of lights. You can talk to children. I actually have a nephew who is an experiencer, which I recognized when he was 18 months old. And he would talk to me about that. I'd say, you know, he said, oh, yeah, I talked to God. I go, well, what does God tell you? And he said, oh, I read different things. And when he was four, he woke up one morning and he went to my brother. He'd never really been religious of any kind. Most of these people may get more religious, but many times get less religious and more spiritual in terms of their. But he said, I want you to, he got my brother up and said, I want you to take me to church, buy me a white shirt, and take me so I can see what this God thing's about. 4 years old. And so my brother did. And for a while, he had all kinds of books and things. And when he started talking to the Jehovah Witness and they'd run away, then we knew he was probably onto something there and he would stay with that. But he used to talk about the city of lights, the light beings, all of these things. They have heightened perceptions of noise, of visions, of smell, all kinds of heightened perceptions of things. Very difficult for them, and we'll talk a little bit about how things could seem to be really wonderful, but could be difficult. While they're there, they have a sense of all knowledge, and they know everything they want to know. They do not bring all of this back. Children bring back the first way you can, and there's an article in the newsletter there, many times they will start using whole sentences or vocabulary that's really too advanced for them and have an understanding of things. When Matthew was maybe 2 years old, not much older than that, he went to get his first haircut. And the hairdresser was trying to talk to him to keep him entertained, I guess, so he wouldn't be afraid. And she said, well, what do you want to do when you grow up, Matthew? And he said, oh, I'm going to be a minister. And she said, oh, really? And, you know, nobody had heard that before. And so when she got done, she said to my brother, did you know Matthew's going to be a minister? Now, he is little. And my brother Kevin said, I had no idea, I never heard about this, Matt. And he said, well, what'd you think? I was going to be an architect or an illustrator? And, you know, he's just doesn't know what to say, because where does he find these words? And ever when he was small, he would just put these sentences together and he would know these things. And we all were like, oh my God, it's really interesting what he really does know. Many people get a message about their life's purpose. This is really important for those people who had attempted suicide and had a near-death experience. What we know is those people who attempt to suicide and have a near-death experience and get a sense of not my job to do this, and get a sense of what my life, what I'm supposed to be doing, they're not likely to ever try that again. A sense of oneness and interconnectedness, really, really very close for people to understand this. And all of this, is, if you can imagine, all these things are kind of shocking. I had a what our generation would call an old brown shoe soldier. He called me one day, saw my picture in the paper. There was an article about NDEs, and this is years and years ago. And he said, I have to talk to you. And he had a ruptured aneurysm, and typically those people, even if they're sitting on the OR table, don't live. And he did. And he said, I'm having all these things happen. He said, I walk outside, I see the birds singing, and it's beautiful, and I cry. I go, you know, here, and I have an understanding of someone and what's going on with it, I cry. He said, I think I'm going crazy. I said, you're perfectly normal, because he had told me enough to know that he was a near-death experiencer. So that interconnectedness is very real, and all of these things, if you imagine having these and trying to say, what's going on with me? What if you don't understand it? And if you don't have anybody there to help you and say, this is a normal event, we can find somebody to talk to you. Light and sound sensitivity. As Matthew got older, I said to my brother, because all the boys in the family are hockey players, and I said, Matt's not going to want to play hockey. It's too violent, it's too loud, it's too bright, and so you need not to push him in that direction. And he didn't want to do it. And I said, let him pick something that is important to him. And at 12, he decided he wanted to be a scuba diver. Took the exam, went through the whole thing, which is very difficult, and passed and has been a scuba diver ever since. He's in the Navy now. And this is significant because I have been at a luncheon at one of the IANS conventions where an ambulance went by and every experiencer at the table immediately covered their ears because that shrill noise was really hurtful. And so the whole sound and light thing is a very real thing. Most of these people become more altruistic. In the newsletter, Mike was a chopper pilot and then called to ministry and retired as a minister last year. They become more joyful, acquire laughter, and just are all around happier people. And as I told Mike, if you ever, he said he's a hugger, if you ever come to an IANS convention, you can't get out of there without somebody hugging you. And, you know, it's all about the love. It's about we want to share the love with you. More creative, interested in subjects not previously known. A guy from upstate New York who was in training for a Olympic being a cyclist. And that's all he'd ever cared about. That's all he ever did. Didn't do much with academics or any of that. Said he'd never read an entire book in his life. And all of a sudden, he had a car fall on his chest and had a near-death experience. And after that, he started scribbling little equations and people's names, and he was very interested in all these different kinds of things. And so he went to the library, and he said to the lady, "Do you know anybody by the name of Max Planck? And you see this equation? Do you know where that might be?" Well, it was in quantum physics, about a book on quantum physics, and he's the father of quantum physics. And every equation he had was absolutely accurate. He just didn't know what it was. And so a lot of people become very interested in spiritual things, in quantum physics, in other kinds of things. Another after effect is most people who have had NDEs are not afraid of dying. They no longer fear death. They feel like they know what it's going to be like, and that's it. So they're not afraid of dying. They become more spiritual. They really may be less religious. They abstract easily and really understand things differently. They have a little time management problem. So if you want to get something in the military or something done right on time, a near-death experiencer is probably not the one to ask to do it. Very generous. And these are after effects. You say, well, what could be wrong with that? Until you see a near-death experiencer who was walking home, and there was a homeless lady with her child. He had just been paid. He said, "I have food at home, you don't," and gave his entire check away to this woman and child. Well, her, you know, his wife was not real excited about that. So yes, it's important to be generous, but you know, all of these things have to be balanced. Very much expanded concepts of love. And when these people come back many times, they are so focused on a purpose, and their relationships with their family are very different, because now they understand a universal love, they understand their family love, but they also know that it's a concept that's bigger than just them. It does challenge to maintain old relationships. And so you have people, so you have people that, you know, it's difficult for them because they're trying to tell their friends, they're trying to tell their family. That is a place where you can all intervene and help them, because they don't understand it. It's much better now. 30 years ago, when I came home from Vietnam, I was absolutely adamant that this was a nursing issue, a medical issue. All nurses and doctors needed to know about this, and they have to be able to support patients who have done this. And I used to teach all the chaplains in the Army. I also have been invited, a lot of the lectures I've done have been initiated from chaplains in different military hospitals or different areas. And so they can be very helpful to people to help explain how relationships change. And one of the things that they're very convinced of is what their life purpose is now. And they are really focused on what they want to do, which can, I know one example of a couple of soldiers who came home and started a not-for-profit. And they are there every day, every week, really doing, and their family has pretty much taken second place to this. And I have tried to help them. I said, you've got to find a balance with this, because it will ruin their relationship with their family if they don't try to understand it. They have heightened sensations of touch, taste, smell, and texture. Really important. Some people have end up over the time having psychic ability. Well, you can imagine how that is confusing for somebody. Increased interest in learning. Their thought process changed. They are really out there sometimes, but have really creative solutions to things. Very curious. Their body clocks don't work very well sometimes, and they are up when they should be sleeping and all of those things. Another after effect that we see a lot is they have allergies, and they have a lot of sensitivity to drugs, to washing soap, because it has a lot of toxins in it, and they'll have rashes. So they have a lot of sensitivity to medication and any other kind of chemical. Multiple sensing is what it's called. They will talk about tasting color or seeing music. And it's multiple things that you can imagine if you can do this, all of a sudden is very, very confusing. Electrical sensitivity. Most, or I'd say at least many near-death experiencers have trouble wearing a watch that has a battery in it. They buy a new battery, it dies. They buy another new battery, it dies. So they eventually figure out how to have solar or mechanical watches. We all have electrical sensations around us. And I know of some experiencers. I know of one woman who had 3 near-death experiences. And for years, she would set up computers, and they'd go all cattywampus when she was near them. When we had a conference once at the University of Washington, in the hotel there, there's about 400 people, about 300 of them were experiencers. And the first thing they said was, we have no idea, but our entire computer system has just stopped working. Couldn't find any reason why. And we all knew why, but we just said, well, we don't know. We don't know what's going on here. It was interesting because there were another conference there and some businessmen. And I was on the elevator with one of them, and he said, you know, to see this stuff about the near-death conference, don't you think those people look pretty good for being near death? He thought everybody there was near death. So there's a lot of misunderstanding. We talked about the sensitivity to light and sound. Really difficult with families if the families don't understand it and they don't have anybody to help them validate this experience with their families. Many times they will have lower blood pressure. So the physical after effects are really important, because if you went to the hospital and have a big sensitivity to medication and can't take as much as other people, your blood pressure is lower than usual, and you have a temperature, normal temperature is 98.6, and if you have a temperature normal that's 96.2, they're not going to understand, and they won't recognize when you're in trouble. Because if your normal temperature is 96.2 and you have a 100 fever, which is a low-grade fever, you're really sick, and they will not know that. So there are some things that are really important. Less tolerant for medication. They can overdose you very easily because you don't have the same tolerance. They don't have great tolerance for violence. I know a hospital administrator who was a great boxing fan. After his near-death experience, couldn't watch it, kept turning the TV off. They don't like anything that's not natural. They don't like violence. There were a lot of things that he loved prior. And now, I mean, he was constantly getting up and turning the TV off from his family and said, I can't watch this. We talked about less materialistic, they're not interested in money. This is a big problem and why many of them are divorced. If you have an experiencer who was a stockbroker and all about money and all about houses and cars and those kinds of things, and he's all of a sudden not about those things, doesn't care about that. He wants to study spirituality. He wants to look at other things, maybe healing. And the wife is not on that same page of music still. So it becomes a problem and creates a divide for divorce many times. Just so you know who's working in the area now, there is a Dr. Eben Alexander. He's a neurosurgeon. He thought all of this was poppycock, and it was just about the brain dying. And he went into a coma for 7 days, and his brain actually was dying and not having any activity. And when he recovered and fully recovered, which was amazing in itself, and he's been now speaking, his book is called Proof of Heaven, was a non-believer and now is out talking to other doctors. The other one that, there are many of them, but Dr. Mary Neal is a orthopedic surgeon up in Montana someplace. She went on a kayak trip in the middle of South America in Brazil, in the where there weren't a lot of people, and they were starting on a river jaunt. There was no place to get off this river until they got to the end. Somebody with less experience got in her way, and she had to go over a falls that she didn't intend to. And her kayak went underwater and stuck under the waterfall, 10 feet under the water. She could not get out. She knew how to get out, but the pressure of the waterfall. And after 30 minutes of this torrent of water, both her legs broke, and that allowed her to slip out of her kayak. Of course, by this time, she was dead. And she's floating down the river, face down in the water. And eventually her friends, because they had been looking for her but couldn't find her, saw her, pulled her out of the water, and of course they tried to do CPR. And it was amazing because she talks about in her book her near-death experience and her going toward the light and trying to just keep going. She had 4 kids. And she said, I knew I had these kids, I knew I had to take care of them, but I knew they were going to be all right, and I just wanted to stay in that place. But then she has these friends over here yelling at her, Mary, Mary, please breathe, please come back. And she'd go back and forth, and you know, and eventually she went back and took a breath, and of course that really invigorated them. And then, but during her near-death experience, she was told that her son would not live to be 18 years old. And so imagine coming back with that information and thinking, now what do I do about that? And of course, there's nothing you could do about it. And just in the last couple of years, she started talking about it. There are some really good things on YouTube. If you just look at near-death experience, and her son did die before he reached his 18th birthday. She's still a practicing orthopedic surgeon. Why these things are difficult for service members? They many times see buddies during the incident who were also injured or killed, and many times they know who's gonna live and who's gonna die, and they see these souls, so to speak. It's very, very emotional and personal. I know Michael, when he started to tell me about his experience, and we're talking 40 years later and he's just talking about it, he knew exactly the detail, and he just, had a rush of emotion about how emotional this was. They're afraid. They think that this might affect their benefits, or somebody will say they're crazy. If they want to stay on active duty, they're worried that this could affect it. And they're afraid nobody will believe them. And that is terrible for them. Certainly worried about security clearances, those that are still on active duty. And they may not remember the experience, but they have all these after effects, and they know something happened, but they have after effects but don't remember the experience. This happens to about 10% or more people. They had an incident, they have all these after effects, but they don't remember the experience. Doesn't mean they didn't have it, they just don't remember it. The military is typically in the VA just throwing them in with PTSD people, you know, in once a month club, not going to be helpful, or putting them on psychotropic drugs and all kinds of things that are just not helpful for them. If addressed correctly, they may be able to help themselves in recovery, but they have to be able to own the experience. Support guidelines for all of us are things like listening. They just need to talk about it, own it. They do not need to be preached to be have some kind of a religious interpretation. We at IANS do not attach any religious interpretations, because all religions have these. Even people who don't believe in an afterlife have these, you know, in different cultures. But the listening is most important. Not don't judge the experience. Keep eye contact with these people and provide them with resources. We have lots of resources. We have groups all over the country. We have 44 groups all over the country where people could go and sit on a group and tell about their experience, listen to other people, get information. You can call our headquarters. We have people there to talk. We, you know, they become a member. They get a monthly or a quarterly magazine. We have lots of resources. So that really is important. Let them tell their story, but don't try to analyze it. Really, really important. And referring them to IANS, because to many people that, I can't tell you the number of people who I've seen, and they were near-death experiencers, and they had never told anybody, and I say, please come to our conference, because for the first time in your life, you're going to feel like you're home. You don't have to explain it to anybody. Everybody there, all the doctors, nurses, experience knows it, knows what it is. You're just going to learn about it and be able to learn different things. Important to look for clues, because, you know, in the hospital, they're going to need somebody and in their life to talk to their families. Don't assume all clergy, because many people assume the clergy should know about this. But they don't. Same with doctors. They don't know about it. And so that's part of why I'm here today, to give you enough information so you'd at least know how to call us and be able to refer these people to a group or get you some help or whatever it is you might need. The patient, let them enjoy the experience and encourage them to write it down. We talked about listening, and of course, if they're in the hospital, I always encourage nurses to chart it and get patients with a local IANS group and be patient with them as they're trying to do this. Some patients, and these are clues, some patients will, or soldier members say, oh, I had the strangest dream. And then if you really look at them and say, you know, I'm interested, what happened? They'll say, well, it really wasn't a dream. I had this experience. But they have to see in your eyes that you're willing to listen to them and talk to them. They sometimes have this faraway look in their eyes. You know, like to have lights on, not afraid of dying. And many times when they're in a hospital or in a hospice care, again, another place where you're there frequently, they are coming and going. They're coming to the other side, and then they're coming back. And there is a phenomenon known as nearing death awareness in a book by Maggie Callanan called Final Gifts. And they are near-death experiences and nearing death awareness are different. She talks about the end stages of communication with hospice patients. But many hospice patients will come and go, and you can just see it. I was with my mother when she died, and that was my intent, to keep her at home and let her be surrounded by loved ones. I have totally changed my practice as a nurse about people who were dying. And she had been up every day until that day, and I could tell by the way she looked that this was going to be the day. So I called my whole family. And everybody came. All the kids came. They all got in bed with Grandma. And Grandma was a little foggy. She'd sort of, yeah, look at you, and then she'd kind of go away for a while. But then she looked up, and she said, Bud. And I said, Mom, it's Dad. He's coming to get you. It's okay. You can leave now. We're going to be all right. You know, you go with Dad, and he's going to take you to the other side. And that was it. She just laid her head back down and smiled, and it was over. And that, I thought, was the most loving thing I could do for her, is have her family, her kids, and tell her it's okay. It's because so often, and especially parents with children who are dying, and sometimes with adults, don't leave me, don't go, don't die, and you know, they're just desperately trying to get out of here. And I tell them all the time, please be prepared, because the minute you walk out of this room, they're leaving. And you know, you need to know that. It's not about you, it's about what they want. And so these are some resources for our organization, telephone numbers, my personal email, and we have another email if you have veterans that want to talk about this but really don't know quite what to do, vethelp@ians.org. They can write an email to that email, and it will come directly to me. Because a lot of times they don't want it to get mixed up in the general email. They want somebody who is a military person who knows what they're talking about. And so really important to be able to refer them to somebody, get them some help, and we're very, very happy to help them. Because our soldiers are dying. They're committing suicide, and they're not being helped. And many of them have had these near-death experiences, and they just want somebody to listen to them. And you are the perfect people to be there for them. But you have to be at least knowledgeable enough that these exist. There are certain things that happen. We have several clergy that belong to IANS and, you know, get newsletters. And we have a couple on the board because they offer a different perspective for people. So we're really... Has everybody got that needs that? So we need to be knowledgeable enough to help them. Nurses, doctors, clergy, most important. And they will frequently, the disabled vets, are going to come and find somebody who maybe now they'll talk to somebody because they've already got retired. and they're not quite as afraid. But they've got to find somebody who is open to talking about it. Or, you know, we do have many cancer patients who are also in hospice, and many of you work with hospice. So important to know the difference between a near-death and a near-death awareness, and helping the family understand what's going on. So that is, and I could talk for about 8 hours and give you 4,000 examples. And if you're interested, if you go on our webpage, IANDS.org, there are all kinds of experiences, letters from experiencers. If you go on YouTube and look up near-death experiences, several of my lectures. 20 years ago, I did an interview with a young man during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and it really hasn't changed a lot since we did that interview. I'm here because I'm supposed to be here, and my path obviously was driven in this direction, and it happened 40 years ago, and I'm still passionate about we need to help these folks. And so I'm really happy to answer any questions or give you any references or anything you'd like to ask me. Yes, sir.
I had something that happened to me when I first went into service. I had a kidney, not a kidney, but a hemorrhagic sinus. And I went to the big hospital, and I got on the elevator, and I passed out on the elevator. And when I woke up, I was up over my body and watching the doctor work on me. And the next time, when I must have went back to sleep, when I woke up again, I was in the bed. And I think that was probably what that was.
Yep.
Read it 40 years ago when I was called into the ministry. All of my, the friends that I had around me that was called into the ministry, they all was getting churches, and I wasn't. And so one day I called God on the carpet and asked him if he really called me to preach. And what he did, he let my life flashback before me. I saw times when I should have died and all of that. And I came out of it saying, I don't know if you called me or not, but I ain't going back there. And so the guys that looked and said, who are you talking to? I said, nobody, I just think.
And that's yes, I'm sure it was a near-death experience. And a lot of people then have an ability to converse and pray and get answers and follow their path. I absolutely believe, as we're told by some near-death experiencers, that we make a contract before we come to this world about the lessons that we're going to have, and we agree to do it. And it might not be our lessons, it might be the people we meet, their lessons. And I look and say, why was I led to all these different things? You have to know that 30 years ago, as a young captain, I'm preaching to everybody, you've got to know about these things. Well, how well do you think that went over? And, you know, they were like, she's crazy. There's nothing written about this. They used to call me the death and dying lady. But I was on active duty all those times, and the more rank I got, the more I made everybody listen to me. And, you know, we just kept going. And then many years later, all of a sudden, it's on television. Every movie star's had one. You know, then there's stuff written about it, and now it's a pretty common household word. The media gets it totally messed up because they will put Jane Seymour, who is Dr. Quinn, medicine woman, has had an NDE, and she'll talk about it, and the next person they have is a truck driver who ran into a bridge and nearly died, but didn't have an NDE, and they have them in the same experience, which they're totally different things. So the media doesn't always get it right, but they're starting to ask more about it, and you'll see more about it. And many, many people have had near-death experience. Quite a few movie stars have had them. Not that we get them to talk too much about it, but you'll hear about it occasionally. Anybody else have a question? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. Okay, I mean, I've been nursing ever since. I've kind of gotten into it through my mom and different things. And I started out as a nurse's aide and everything else. I mean, I worked my way up through the rank and actually became an LPN. And I worked all different shifts. And I know one time, one of my best friend's husband passed away, and my mom had happened to call me, because I'd been working somewhere else in a totally different area where I originally came from. She called me, and I had just gotten off from work from where I was working, and she's like, "Are you sitting down or not?" And I'm like, "No." She goes, "Well, sit down." And I'm going, "I just got up from work. I don't want to sit down. Just tell me what's going on." She goes, "Well, I was trying to get a hold of you all night long, and the other thing is, the accident that happened was right where my older sister had lived. It happened right in that kind of area." Mm-hmm. And I turned around and I said, "Just, Mom, sit there and tell me." And she's like, "Well, your best friend's husband passed away." And then, I've had other experiences where I came close to that I could have been dead. And yet, I've always felt like I've always been protected. And it's just kind of like everywhere I've been and all every situation that I've been in, that I could either been killed or whatnot, mm-hmm. It seems like the angels have been here. Because anymore, it seems like there's a lot of road rage, people not paying attention. It's like everybody's so busy in their own little world that nothing seems to go right. Even when you're not looking for the accident, it happens.
Well, and we hear a lot of that. It's not unusual. Of course, I've heard hundreds and hundreds of different stories, and many of the most interesting ones are from children because they don't have any expectations. They, aren't watching this. They just tell you whatever happened. I died. I went to heaven. I saw God. He told me this. Very interesting. But this one circumstance, a lady told me that her mother was in the hospital, and she was not expected to live. And so they were home, and they'd been at the hospital all day. They came home. And they had a son that was like 2 years old. And all of a sudden, they heard him talking in his bed. And he's standing up in his crib, looking up in the corner, talking to his grandmother and saying, "Yes, Nana, okay." And he was talking. They get a call immediately that she had just died. And so, the spirit can go where it's going to go. And very interesting things happen. We had a lady who had a heart attack. She was in the ER. She feels herself going up and separating from her body. She goes out to the waiting room. Out there is her whole family. She can hear and see everything they're doing. And her brother comes bashing in and said, "Oh, wouldn't you know she'd have this right now? I'm on my way out of town on a business trip and yada, yada, yada," And of course she was resuscitated, and he goes in to see her. And what do you think the first thing she said to him was? She said, "I heard everything you said." And she repeated it to him. And, there are so many interesting stories. So this is certainly something that is going to be studying in the past. It's a lot of work in consciousness now. And we're going to see more and more of this. Let's just get this lady here.
My question is for you is,
Yes.
And then what are their characteristics afterwards?
People, we don't call them negative, but we call them frightening experiences. We hear very little about them because people are afraid to talk about the positive ones, so you can imagine how they feel. They tend to be, sometimes they'll talk about being more isolated or what I've seen, I know one person in 40 years who's told me about their experience, and it was integrated in a very positive way over the years. They have the same characteristics, but sometimes they feel lonely and pushed aside and those kinds of things. And so, yes, people have them. We just don't hear about them very often. But they tend to be integrated over time in the same way. Yes, ma'am.
I hear a lot of near-death experiences from medical professionals. My sister was a nurse. She just retired from 42 years in Florida. But more so than near-death is at the end of life, like with my mother. My mother was only released when my sister whispered something into her ear. She says, "I'm going to die." As soon as she left, she died. But a lot of times, as chaplains, I go to the VA hospital a lot. And usually people call me and say, "Look, my brother or my uncle is in the hospital. I know you're there all the time. Can you go and stop by and just pray with them or whatever?" And usually I ask them if they would like for me to pray for them. I never just go in and pray for somebody, I ask them. But I find that there is a release mechanism from the family. Do you have anything that you can tell the family that's important as far as the release? Because a lot of times you don't want your loved ones to leave.
Yeah.
You know, no matter how ill they are, you just want them one more day.
Yeah, one more minute. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, to stay around, and they're only looking for that.
They're looking, or they will take it. You know, the minute you leave, because the family's making it too difficult. What I tell the family many times, I said, and a lot of times it's because they think they're going into a black hole someplace. And I said, this is, you know, read something about this. This is going to be a wonderful experience for them. Let them go. Give them guidance, let them have permission to transition, and many of them will then do that. Children are the hardest. Parents have a horrible time letting go of children, and I once walked in a room where they were kind of holding vigil, and I said, "Why don't you go get a coffee or something? I'll sit here with your son." He was like six or so, and I said, "How are things going?" He said, "I'm dying and my parents won't let me go." And I mean, he really knew what was going on. He said, "I want to go." And so I did spend some time with those parents because it was very, very difficult for them to let go. So I think, just a minute, I want to make sure we get everybody over here. So that's, I tell them, and if I'm in the room, you don't have to say it out loud. You know, they're out there floating around someplace, and you just say, "It's okay, go ahead and go." And yes, ma'am, you wanted to say, yeah.
What would you recommend we say to somebody that I would say is probably a negative NDP, and tell them that they need help? How would you suggest we say that?
Well, I'm not sure what you're talking about. If I don't necessarily know that they need help. Are you talking about somebody who tells you they had a frightening near-death experience?
I have a couple of relatives that are military people that are sightseeing too much, and they come home with negative, meaning they need to be more positive in life, and they just have a hard time moving.
Well, that's a whole different realm of stuff. You're talking mostly PTSD and some of those things, and yes, they do need help, and definitely. And it's very helpful to tell people, get them on YouTube and let them look at some of the things about near-death experiences, because then they know it's not over, they know there's something beyond us, and, you know, all of that.
They appear to be afraid to talk about it.
Yeah, yeah. You wanted to ask something, ma'am?
For some people, this is probably a new thing, even though we have heard of near-death experience. But from speaking from a person who is a chaplain or minister or whatever field you may be in, if someone comes and has that story and may not recognize, or they do recognize it's a near-death experience, how would you direct, say, me for example, if I wanted to help them through this process?
Yeah.
Yet, are you saying just have them?
I would say to them, you know, I've heard about this experience. It's a very normal experience. Let me give you some. I typically would encourage chaplains to join so they have newsletters and get other kinds of things and say, let me share this with you. Here's a website. You know, and give them that information and say, there's a lot of people that have had this experience and it can be very joyful and, you know, go read about it. And I think that's what helps people is when they do this extensive reading.
And just a follow-up question. Once you give them the information and say, I give them your email, would you suggest that it's okay to do follow-up to say,
oh, absolutely. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And for all of you to kind of watch some of this stuff and get knowledgeable yourself, because one out of one go, we're all going to die. Wouldn't it be nice to know what may be on the other side? And so, you know, as you look up some of this stuff and hear some of these things, you'll find yourself being able to talk about this and be supportive to that person. But as long as you know where to send them, that's key.
I have another question. Okay, for some of the people, okay, you know they're going to pass away, but yet, have you ever dealt with a person who has, like, how many have you ever dealt with that have stayed and hang on for clinging until a certain person comes and then they'll go away? I mean, I've experienced it, even with my own.
That happens a lot. People wait for different things before they are ready to let go, and that's something you should know and help them. And sometimes you're looking for what that thing is or what that person is. And there's a wonderful book called Nearing Final Gifts, and it's about those things and about those communications by Maggie Callanan. Final Gifts. Callanan. Yes?
My first husband, before he died, he would look up and he says, do you see them? And we would say, see who? He said his mother and father and first cousin had died 2 months before he did.
Mm-hmm.
And what he would do, and we'd say, well, what, do they say anything to you? And he said, they're telling me to come on. So myself and his baby sister were telling him, you know, next time they come, if you want to go, just go.
Yeah, that's exactly there. There are people that are going to be there to help them transition, and you need to encourage them. I kind of call it now, I mean, it's a whole different way of practicing than what I was even taught. I talk about being a midwife at the end of life. Let's shelter them out with love and caring and help the family understand that and have a wonderful transition.
He would sit on the side of his bed and sing a spiritual song up above my head.
And, yes, sir.
Yeah, are premonitions ever associated?
Yes, they are. Many near-death experiencers have premonitions, and if you do have some of these, a good thing to do is keep a journal. And if you're having premonitions, write down. And then if it happens, write down when it happens. And but there's quite a bit written about that on our website.
I'm glad I came today because I've experienced some of the things I didn't know how to ever articulate. So today I was wounded in Iraq, and 2 days before I got wounded, I had a dream, a premonition that was the most lifelike, felt like I was actually there, physically present, experiencing like the situation that actually happened to me a couple days later. And then when it actually happened, I remember the hovering over yourself thing, but that's all I remember.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm glad I understand.
Yeah, just keep reading about it, and the more you read about it, the more understanding you have. And it's very comforting, even if you're not a near-death experiencer, to know this stuff and to look at, you know, how these things might help all of us. And
one of the things I'm taking away, Ms. Diane, is the fact that it could be misdiagnosed as PTSD.
Oh, absolutely.
And, you know,
absolutely.
Disabled American veterans, guys, you know, I wonder how many of our veterans are walking out here and they're taking the drugs because there's not that understanding of the...
We had a young Marine walk into our office. His job was computer specialist. And he went to the VA to try to talk about his NDE. They told him he was bipolar. They put him on all this medication. He couldn't function. And he came and wanted to know. He said, can you help me? And we certainly were able to get him off all the medication. We just acknowledged his experience and we talked about it. And, you know, before 6 months or so, he was back to work. The other thing I would say is children have these experiences a lot. They're going to give you one time. They'll say to the parents, I died. I went to heaven. I saw my spiritual brother. And when they talk about, fantasy children or what people call it, they are not. They're spiritual children. And these kids, if you don't acknowledge what they say, they won't talk about it anymore, and they're going to be so in isolation over the years if a parent or a teacher does not understand, because the kids come back with great skills, verbal skills, very creative, but they kind of function out of the box. And so they're going to have things that really need parents to be able to support them and provide them an environment where they can be what they need to be.
No more questions? Ms. Diane, this has been very informative. Thank you. You have to put a disclaimer out here, though, chaplains, and those that are not chaplains, but you're here for information. You're not a subject matter expert in this field. What we've done today, what Ms. Diane has done today, is giving you the characteristics to look out for so that as now you have a better understanding, you can now get that veteran the appropriate help. My concern is we've probably got too many veterans out here that are being drugged and don't need to be.
Yeah.
All they have to do is talk about it. You're not a subject matter expert, but now that you're armed with this information that Ms. Diane has given you, you can recognize some of the things and say, hey, because what do chaplains do? We develop relationships, and we want people to talk to us. And when you're hearing one of those or multiple 15 characteristics that she's laid up there, you say, you know, sounds to me like you had a near-death experience. Did you have one? And then open that wall or that break down that wall, open that door of conversation, and then go from there. And then, if you have determined that's what it is, call Ms. Diane. You got her email?
Yeah,
I hope
you've got my email. You've
there
got the
go.
Organization's telephone number.
Yeah.
And we will help you. It's really helpful if you're really interested in this. If you like join as a basic member and you'll get all these updates about conferences, about newsletters and stuff, and it keeps you informed about what the latest thing on NDEs is and going on. We will be meeting in September in San Antonio, Texas, the 3rd through the 6th. And I am pushing for veterans to come. offering disabled veteran scholarships to come. So if you have some out there, we want these people to be able to come share their experiences. And everything's on our website. All you need is the ians.org, and the conference stuff's there. And if there's any issues, just the staff will give you my number and get a hold of me.
Well, Donnie, what I'm hoping in this environment that we're in right now is PTSD wasn't recognized by the federal government as a medical issue until, what, 10, 15 years ago?
Yeah.
And I'm hoping by, the reason why Diane's here and her team is because when I got wind of this through Linda and we talked a little bit, I said, no one talks about that. I don't even know what experiences these folks go through. And I thought it would benefit you at this convention, giving you additional information. And so now, hopefully, we've getting the word out. You have a better understanding of what's going on. And maybe 10 to 15 years from now, we'll be able to bring this to the forefront of the medical profession and in our profession as chaplains and folks that have a better understanding of this. And we just may see a turnaround and maybe less prescriptive drugs being issued to these veterans. Because in every case that you talked about that I heard, is that when they finally got with you and your team and these resources, 6 months later they were okay. They come off the drugs. Now, it's not saying that everybody's going to come off those drugs. There may
be a different reason while they're on some drugs, but it really is very helpful if they get an opportunity to talk about their experience. And it takes years for things to change. And I'm very happy to come out to states or other conventions that you have and talk about this and continue this, because I started out in the early 70s. There was not one book written. And I'm out there talking about this, and half the people thought I was crazy. And now, here we are 40 years later, there are thousands of books, people telling their story, lots of stuff on YouTube. And lots of stuff. Now I get calls every week about documentaries that are being done. I've done four radio shows in the last month. So people are talking about it. People are trying to get a hold of it and do something with it.
Well, look, Chaplain. Oh, go ahead. Ask a question.
I have a question for you. Have you heard about Heaven Is for Real?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, that was a good movie and a good book. Mm-hmm. And the fact that it was from Nebraska, a little boy.
Yeah.
Nebraska.
But are you from Nebraska? Are you from Nebraska?
Oh, yeah. But it's a good book.
It's important because it's, once again, children out of the mouth of babes, many times come those things, and parents question whether they should believe what they're talking about, and they really should.
Well, what I want to do, ladies and gentlemen, I want to go ahead and wrap this up. And this was very, very good. Diane, I just can't express I'm glad you came. I'm glad we didn't talk much, in the bridging the gap and getting her coordinated here. I'm glad whoever told you how to get here, God bless them. Let me know. I'll go thank them. But chaplains, I'm going to go back to your responsibility. We talk about a little black book, right? Chaplains should have a little black book, and then we'll finish with this. In that black book that you should be carrying should be, the DAV is great in helping veterans, but maybe your chapter is not financially well enough off that you can cut a check to help a veteran that is suffering or can't pay the rent or can't. You need to know in your communities, nonprofit organizations, or other organizations that can assist you in getting that veteran or family care. And if you have a little black book, because I do for my community, and it lists all, and they don't have to be DAV. DAV is the primary place I go. I want DAV to be the forefront, but I understand that not everybody's well off at their chaplain. Then you should know where you can take that veteran or his family within your community to get the help that they need, okay? So carry a little black book. You need to put Diane's information in your black book right now, okay? And then from that moment forward, understand this, is that you're not a subject matter expert. Maybe you are a SME in certain areas, but guys, I don't expect chaplains to be subject matter experts in everything. I am not, okay? But I'm smart enough to know that I have points of contact that I can refer to when I recognize the issue to get them where they need to go. That's your business. 98% of my ministry, you know what 98% of my ministry is? It should be 98% of yours. Listening. And Diane brought that up on a slide. You just need to be listening. Okay? And sometimes with my bubbly personality, I get to talking and yakking. I'm not listening very well. So I have to pull back sometimes. Okay? But you have to know the situation. When to be bubbly and personally and happy and joyful. Because I like bringing joy in people's lives. I like the smiles on their faces. And then when there's that moment that you as a chaplain need to step back for just a moment and say, talk to me. 90% of your ministry should be listening. If you're doing all the talking as a chaplain, you're not ministering at all. I guarantee you you're not. So take the time to listen. That other 1%, usually I'm talking to someone about DAV. If you've not been a service officer, let me tell you something about that experience. Mm-hmm. When you become a service officer, you get the background of the DAV's mission, and you can apply that to the ministry that you have. And I was a service officer for about 4 years, gave me great understanding how the DAV works, the VA works, and now I bring that into ministry if I need to, but I'm going to 98% listen. And then there's that 1%, the other that equals out to the 100%. There's that other 1% where you're actually giving spiritual advice. All right? It's not always giving out your point of view about your faith. It's not about that. It's about listening, developing relationships, and then that opens doors for you to walk into, because now they feel comfortable with you, and chaplains should always make those that come around them feel comfortable. Okay? Put this information in a black book. Start. If you don't have a black book, start doing it. You're not a subject matter expert in anything. You may be in some things, but I don't expect you to be a subject matter expert in anything. Don't be. It's too much information. My head would explode. I would go crazy just trying to know everything. I don't want to know everything. Yes, ma'am.
One other comment, though, about it, too, is sometimes you need to step back yourself to have, like, yourself time to reiterate yourself. Because if you get too many, I've got lots of different friends, and all of us are all in that same boat. Some of our mental illnesses, and especially if they're in leadership and they expect a yes or a no answer, but you can't get, you know, they're getting some of those people that expect the yes answer, and you can't give it to them. They'll explode.
All right. Well, don't be giving everybody the next article, I'm writing, okay? But you know, my faith teaches me that we're supposed to do self-reflection, right? We're supposed to do self-reflection.
I think one thing that the chaplains that's so important besides listening, it's just availability to hear what they're saying.
Absolutely.
Because sometimes you can be listening and you hear nothing because you're so covered with your own stuff.
Absolutely. Did you all hear that? Chaplain's availability. Not only must you listen, but make yourself available. If you're wrapped up in life's turmoil, how are you going to make yourself available to someone who really wants to talk to you? And remember what I said, it isn't about your education, it isn't about your certifications, I don't care how many certificates you have hanging on the wall, all I require of you as a chaplain is you got to care. And caring is making yourself available and listening. That's how people know. Oh, I love that eye contact too, that you put up there. Make the eye contact. It was a lesson I learned in my own marriage. And my wife always knew I wasn't listening when I didn't make eye contact with her. She knew I wasn't listening. And she said, Dover? And every time she called me Dover, my antennas went up and I focused on my wife. And I knew I was in trouble. Okay? Oh, and speak common language. I'll explain. When I was in the military and I married my wife and we're driving down the road on the interstate, I started giving her all these Army acronyms. I just started talking about Army. So, you know, PDQ, RFT, whatever the case may be. I mean, I just unloaded on it. Well, she was a promotions manager for Fox 54 television station in Columbus. And when I got done, you know, unloading on her, She came back and started giving me all the television jargon. And I mean, I looked at her and I was all cocky. I said, what'd you just say? And she gave me that stern finger and says, exactly. You can't communicate and develop relations unless you're speaking the common language, okay? Don't be so spiritual, you're no earthly good, guys. Okay? Stick with the common, that's how you develop your relationships. With that said, I appreciate everyone being here. If you want to stay and talk to Ms. Diane and her team, you're more than welcome to, okay? But I will tell you that next in Atlanta, if I'm elected as your chaplain again, we're going to be talking about disaster relief. That's what I've already got planned in the future. We're going to be talking about disaster relief because we've had a lot of them. All right? With that said, thank you, guys, for everything, and thanks for coming. All right?